In this lecture, I will talk about material requirements for wind turbine blades. After this lecture, you will be able to calculate the load working on a wind turbine blade, calculate the stresses working in the blade material, estimate the number of load cycles in a wind turbine blade. Here I have shown a number of existing wind turbine blades plotted as a function of the length versus the weight of the blades. If you look at the smallest blade, then we can see that the gross weight regarding weight per versus length is following nearly a power of 3. A power of 3 will be the case for pure upscaling of the blade. If you look at the longer blades, then we have actually a gross weight which is a little lower. If we zoom in on the longest blades, then we have two cases here which is made of pure glass, epoxy or polyester. We have, so this is 70 plus long blade, this is 80 plus long blade. This blade is actually also consists of some part of carbon fiber in a load carrying laminate. The final point up here, which is a 86 meter long blade, is a virtual blade, so that's not been produced, but is a reference blade which will be used in an example later in this lecture. The reference to the work describing this blade can be seen here. First, we will look at the aerodynamic load working on a wind turbine blade, meaning the flapwise loading of the blade. You have learned earlier in the course that the maximum load on a wind turbine blade is reached when the wind speed is equal to the weighted wind speed for the wind turbine blade. This speed corresponds to the point where the max production is reached for the turbine, meaning that we are reaching the power of the generator in the turbine. The corresponding loading on this point is given by this small equation here, only consisting the density of the air, showing here as 1.2 kilogram per cubic meter, the weighted wind speed, and the length of the blade. This load will be distributed onto the three wind turbine blades. And actually, the distribution will be a rather linear function going from zero load at the root up to a certain load intensity at the blade tip. This is shown the equation describing this variation as a function of x. When we zoom into to one blade and plot the load intensity on the blade, then we can cut the blade and find the forces working inside the blade. We would like to calculate the moment which are resulting in stresses in the blade material. This can be calculated after the equation shown here, where the red part is coming from the uniform part of the linear distribution of the load, and the blue part is coming from the linear variation part of the loading. It's found by actually finding the total value of the load given by the intensity multiplied with the length of the section and then the point where this load is working. So for the uniform distributed load, we have that the max load will work moment-wise in the midpoint, while for the linear distribution, it will work in the two-thirds point in the blade. This equation can be derived as this one, where we put in the values for the load intensity. So this is giving the moment in an arbitrary point in our blade. In order to make a wind turbine blade, we need to have some materials. And this will generate some gravity load on the wind turbine blade. This loading will be in the edgewise direction of the blade, illustrated here on a wind turbine and on one blade. If we assume that the amount of material used is constant per unit length of the blade, then we have a uniformly distributed load. And the intensity of this load can be written as a function of the density of the material, the amount of material used, and the G constant, which is equal to 10 meter per second squared. Do the similar cutting as we was doing before in the blade material, then we can get out the moment working in the blade material on the cross section. So here's the equation shown for that. And again, we have this uniform load intensity here, and we have that the load will work in the middle point as the intensity multiplied with the length of the section we're looking at, and then the point where the force will work moment-wise. This equation can be derived in this short form here, and this will give the moment in an arbitrary point in our blade. Now we would like to go from the moment in the cross section to actual stresses in the material. In order to do that, we need to look into the cross section of a wind turbine blade. I have an example here where we can see that the load carrying part is the top part here and the bottom part here, and the two parts in the end. So the top part and the bottom part is taking care of the aerodynamic load, while the two parts in the end is take care of the gravity load. This point I illustrated as green points of materials on the sketch. In order to simplify this structure or this cross section, I have drawn a picture here showing some materials which are the flapwise material taking care of the flapwise loading, and which have a height, which is the height of the or the thickness of the blade, and then some material taking care of the edgewise loading with a distance which is corresponding to the width of the blade. The sum of these four materials is the sum of the material used in the wind turbine blade. Now we would like to go from the moment to the stresses in the material, and we have the equation for the moment in an arbitrary point in our cross section. This moment can be recalculated as stresses in a wind turbine blade material, as shown here, with compressive stresses in the top and tensile stresses in the bottom. In order to calculate the relation between the moment in a plate section and the corresponding stresses, we have that the stresses will work as forces given by the stress multiplied by the cross-section area here, and then moment-wise given by the arm from the center line to the point, as shown here. This equation can be derived as this in this form here, where we have the stresses in an arbitrary point along the length of the blade. We can now put the equation in for the flapwise moment in this equation here and get the stresses somewhere in arbitrary point. In a similar way, we can also find, or we have found, the moment work coming from the gravity load on the blade, and we can find the corresponding stresses coming from the edgewise loading of the blade. The wind turbine blade material is not only loaded statically, it's highly loaded in fatigue. And regarding the number of cycles working on a wind turbine, I will show here a small estimate on the number of cycles throughout the lifetime of a wind turbine blade. As an example, I again take the DSU 10 megawatt reference blade. If you look at the material at the tip of the blade, then normally 100 meter per second is considered as a max speed in order to avoid erosion of the polymeric surface on the wind turbine blade. Knowing the length of the blade, then this limit will then give the rotation time of a wind turbine blade. And this is 5 seconds for this specific turbine. Hours of production is here set to 3,000 hours. That's nearly 9,000 hours in a year, but only partly the time is used when the turbine is running. And this is normally the number of hours considered for full production of a wind turbine. And then we are considering the lifetime on 25 years. Putting this together, then we are getting a number of load cycles due to the gravity force equal to 50 million. Following the gravity load, then we also have a wind-induced fatigue. When we are estimating the number of load cycles, we will start, the starting point will be the eigenfrequency of the blade, which will be the order of 1 Hz for this given turbine. Again, taking the hour of production equal to 3,000 hours per year and a lifetime on 25 years, then we are reaching a number of load cycles coming from the wind load on 300 million. In this lecture, you have learned how to calculate the load working on a wind turbine blade, calculate the stresses working in a blade material, estimate the number of load cycles on a wind turbine blade.